What's up, Warriors of Jigoku? Welcome back to some more Warriors Orochi content. We are going to be talking about, in my personal opinion, we're going to rank the best Warriors Orochi story to the worst Warriors Orochi story, but we're actually going to be doing worst to best. So, yeah, so quick disclaimer, I am going to be, like, counting Warriors Orochi 3 Ultimate and Warriors Orochi 4 Ultimate as separate stories. Yes, in ways, they technically are just continuations of, like, the base games of 4 and 3, but I want to count them as their own separate stories because they have their different stuff to bring to the table, unlike their predecessors of the base game. So, again, first and foremost, let me just say real quick, this is an opinion. Relax, just because I'm saying which is worst and best does not mean in any way, shape, or form that my word is factual. And also, be sure to give your thoughts down below. Be sure to rank the stories from worst to best in your honest opinion as well. You can give your opinions as to why, or if you just want to just list them from worst to best or best to worst, then by all means do that as well. But we're going to kick it off immediately. So we're going to start off right off the bat with the very worst Warriors Orochi story. In my personal opinion, I really do think it is Warriors Orochi 4's. Warriors Orochi 4's was really just a huge jumbled mess, very boring. Honestly, it actually almost put me to sleep at times. This was the one story which I absolutely despised more than any other story in the franchise. Honestly, almost every other story seemed pretty solid, but this one in particular was just really, really messed up and boring. Very jumbled up with trying to make every single character seem relevant to the story, and then having a huge group of characters just end up getting, like, powers of the gods and everything. And obviously, people, there's spoilers in this, so if you're not into the spoilers, you shouldn't be watching this video. I'm just going to say that right now. But if you're into the spoilers, sure. But in terms of this one, in terms of Warriors Orochi 4's story, I would actually say you're not missing out on much. There really isn't anything super interesting about this story in the slightest. Yeah, you get to meet new powerful gods and everything that get introduced into this, like the Greek gods, Athena, Zeus, Ares, and then we also have like Odin and then Loki, Perseus and such. But honestly, there really isn't much to deliver to the table. The story itself just felt a very long, drawn-out thing where you just saw paper cutouts just talking most of the time. There wasn't really any cool cinematics that you could really try to enjoy the thing with. There was probably like one or two here and there, but there really wasn't anything really cool about the story whatsoever. Personally, there's not really much I can say aside from just it was just boring. It was just jumbled up. They just tried to give too many characters too much screen time. They tried to make every character relevant in this story, and it really just didn't fit well for this kind of thing. Like, the whole gods thing, yes, it was a cool new thing to see, but it was also a weird thing to also go from, like, going from demons and mystics and everything, and then you're going to just gods. Personally, I thought seeing gods and everything was cool, but at the same time, I thought it was kind of weird to see just, like, we go from, like, cool things like demons and mystics, and I thought they would have branched out more on that, but we ended up getting Greek gods out of the blue and like, Valhalla people and stuff like that. I thought that was really weird. So, personally, I wasn't really 100% invested in the story, and I'm not even gonna lie, I really legit just, like, fell asleep through a lot of it. It was very not well done at all. It felt very sloppily done, it felt very lazily done with how many times you went to go see, like, I kid you not, probably, like, sometimes 8 minutes of dialogue between characters, and you're just seeing them as talking as, like, those paper cutouts that you have, like, when they're just talking to one another. Like, if you remember from Warriors Orochi 3, you got to talk in the camp and everything. That was pretty cool. And this one, you don't get to do that. It's just, you're literally just sitting there, just watching paper cutouts talk to each other. No lip movement or anything. They're just sitting there talking, no moving character models. Just them just sitting there. And it wouldn't have been as bad if they kept it brief, but the problem was they didn't keep it brief. And they were probably sitting there with dialogue for, I kid you not, probably 8 minutes in a video I did once. It was not good. I did not enjoy it at all, but yeah. So, at the end of the day, I thought the final boss actually was pretty suitable. It was actually a pretty good final boss and everything, but it still didn't really make up for the fact that the story was just ridiculously long, overdrawn out, very boring, tiring. It just felt like a grind, and you really don't want story modes to feel like a grind to you. This one really felt like a big grind, and I was not into it in the slightest. But I don't want to keep going on the negativity of that. We're going to try to move on to the very next one, which probably might come as a shock to some of you, but I'll be sure to let you all know, like, why, and I'm going to let you all know beforehand. Like I said, I'm making the ultimates and the base games completely separate from one another, so keep that in mind. I'm doing that. So it's time for us to move on to the next game that is going to be next to Warriors Orochi 4 at the bottom of the list. So as I mentioned, this one's probably going to be a small shocker to some of you, but it is actually going to be Warriors Orochi 3 Ultimate's story. No, not the base games. Like I said, I'm counting those as two separate things. Not the base game of Warriors Orochi 3, but Warriors Orochi 3 Ultimate's story. So there's going to be some redeeming qualities to it, but there's also going to be some reasons why I just personally did not like it. And it's going to have something to do kind of along the lines as Warriors Orochi 4's base game story. But let's get into it immediately so you guys can just let me explain. So for Warriors Orochi 3 Ultimate, the reason why I wasn't hugely onto Warriors Orochi 3 Ultimate story, honestly, for one, I thought the boss in Warriors Orochi 3 Ultimate was not good at all. I thought QB was a cool idea. I thought she had a great design, great combat style and everything, but we're not talking about playability. I'm personally just talking about her just being a final boss and kind of being more of a cowardly kind of final boss opposed to people like Odin, who actually was a really strong boss, Orochi and Orochi X, who were immensely powerful guys who would try to beat the living crap out of you. QB in the story just kind of just tries to get away from you most of the time. And it really just felt like she felt more cowardly and everything. That was one reason right there. I just wasn't into the final boss. She just felt very cowardly and very like, when she realized she was in trouble, instead of like people like Orochi and like Odin who try to beat the living crap out of you. And don't get me wrong, Odin's also pretty cowardly, but at least he was able to put up a fight and did try to run away at the very last mission of the game. Like, yo, stop QB from getting away. That was literally it. That was the final boss for Warriors Orochi 3 Ultimate. It was the fact that you had to go after QB, who was running away from you the entire battle. And I was like, come on, bro. Really? She was literally just running away from you the entire time. And it was kind of stupid to go around the map instead of just have her like booked up somewhere. Like, I think it was in Odawara Castle. Like, instead of just having her booked up in the main keep or maybe one of the main garrisons down south, she was literally just trying to run from you all across the map, if I'm not mistaken. At least near the very end, she was trying to go to escape point, which was literally 10 feet from her, which was also pretty stupid. But it was just, she was not a great villain for Warriors Orochi 3 Ultimate. She was one of the big qualities of why I didn't like the Warriors Orochi 3 Ultimate story. And then there was also parts where you would go and go back to those exact same missions that you did before. And it was personally one of the stupidest things ever. Literally, if you go back to those stages, maybe one or two stages had some differences if you went back into those stages, but other times there would be no difference at all. It really felt like I was just grinding from going to those missions I already completed in the Ultimate story, and I'm going straight back to them just to do basically the exact same thing with maybe a couple differences in the battle here and there, but it really didn't do anything dramatically different. So I really thought that kind of stuff was just kind of silly to put in the story. I really thought QB just wasn't great fitted for a main villain or anything. If she had her own game mode like Hundun did, maybe she would have been better. But personally, in terms of her being a main villain in the story, she was a very lackluster villain. And that's kind of one of the biggest things about it. So the redeeming quality is it did give the upbringing of Orochi. That was probably my favorite thing about the Warriors Orochi 3 Ultimate story. So nothing putting against the Orochi upbringing. I thought that was a really cool thing. And everything, seeing him go from, like, spoilers, seeing him go from a mystic over to, like, the Serpent King Orochi. I thought that was a really, really cool thing. It was awesome to see him as. Apparently, at times, he still seemed like he was a very overpowered person, especially when you see him for the first time. You had to, like, run away from him instead of fighting him. I thought seeing something like that, seeing Orochi, like, really overpowered just in his base state of just the regular old Orochi was really, really cool. So don't get me wrong, it did have that really cool redeeming quality, but at the same time, it was just overclouded with the fact that I just had to go through the same stages twice, and then I also had to deal with a very lackluster kind of final villain in QB for that story. So all in all, it had its redeeming quality, but I still think that story could have been way, 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 way better than it was. But yeah, so let's move on from that. It is time for us to get on to the very next story here. And this is where things start to pick up. This is where I start to think like, okay, this is where stuff started getting better. And I won't really have any like anything bad to say about these other ones. Those were the 4 and 3 Ultimates were probably the ones where I would bash uncontrollably. But, and again, minus the Orochi upbringing. But the other ones, I actually had nothing but praise for. Sure, there might be some things here and there. But honestly, after this next one, it's probably going to be nothing but praise because these were actually the hardest ones to do. Not number one, but number two and three were definitely the hardest ones for me to do. But I guess without further ado, let us get into the next one, which is going to be Warriors Orochi 4 Ultimate. So I bet some of you never expected to see Warriors Orochi 4 Ultimate above Life Warriors Orochi 3 Ultimate. So let me just say real quick to you, if it was just solely based on the entirety of the game, then Warriors Orochi 3 Ultimate would definitely go above that. But we're just talking about the story itself. So keep that in mind. We are only talking about the story. We're not talking about any of the other featured game modes like Gauntlet Mode or Infinity Mode. We're talking just solely on the story. That's it. That is all we're talking about. Any of the things that go with the story mode and nothing else. We're not talking about which game is better. We're talking about which story of the games are better. In my personal opinion, of course. And again, be sure to let me know down in the comments which yours is favorite. Which favorite is yours. But yeah, so let's go about Warriors Orochi 4 Ultimate, which I thought was a big, big plus for Warriors Orochi 4. So Warriors Orochi 4, obviously, like I mentioned, was very drawn out, very boring. And then we had Warriors Orochi 4 Ultimate, which actually was really cool. It brought in a couple more characters and everything. It brought in the return of Ryu Hayabusa, Achilles, and Joan of Arc, or whatever the hell way you want to call her, but I say Joan of Arc. But it was really cool to see all them be put into the story. And it was really cool to see, like, two more gods be brought into the picture. I think it was two more. No, technically three, but technically two at the same time. And I'll get to that in a second. So we had Hades, and then we also had Gaia, and then we also... Oh, no, actually, we did have another new Mystic, which was really cool, actually. I question the fact that that Mystic ended up getting a god form, but we're going to go about that in a second as well. But it was really cool to see a character like Hades, who was actually a very likable character and a very likable, spoiler alert, villain. And then we had Gaia, who was a very lovable kind of character as well, very motherly, very cool. I really did like her. And then we also had the return of Perseus. So for those of you who know, again, spoiler alert, Perseus in the base game was portrayed by Loki, who ended up taking the form of Perseus and everything. And yeah, so we didn't really get to see much about like the actual Perseus, but we ended up seeing Loki take the form of Perseus and then eventually go into his regular form. Like, hey, I was actually Loki the whole time, the god of mischief and shit. So yeah, so it was cool to see that they gave Perseus his own kind of character and everything. That was really awesome. And then you had to go through a couple stages, but the cool thing about this one was, if you really wanted to try to get through the grind of trying to get the characters, which by the way was probably the easiest thing to get the Perseus fragments, you could probably just play that thing on easy and you would have been perfectly fine. You could just breeze through it quickly, breeze through the fights easily. It was perfect. It made you go back into the main story of like the base game, which was, in my opinion, didn't really care because I was just going to breeze through it nonetheless. And you could breeze through it on easy if you wanted to, because it didn't matter what difficulty you played on to get those Perseus fragments. You could just get them immediately. And there wasn't a lot. And you got them more than, like, if it was later chapters, you could get those Perseus fragments. Like, you can get more of them as you went on. It was really cool. I actually really did like going back and getting those Perseus fragments and then eventually getting Perseus. Personally, I haven't played as him too much, so I don't know if he plays any different than Loki. I'm assuming he doesn't. He might maybe have different charge attacks, but I really don't know. Be sure to let me know down in the comments, of course, if there was any difference. But yeah, it was cool to do something like that. See the return of Perseus, see Gaia, see Hades, who ended up being a magnificent villain, in my opinion. I thought he was a really, really cool villain. He was very overpowered. He had a bit of Odin for him, but it ended up, because they ended up doing a twist, if you ended up getting all those Perseus fragments, technically, if you didn't, your final boss would have still been Odin, and that would have been all said and done. But if you got all the Perseus fragments, then you would have been able to unlock the next thing about the next final boss, which was going to be Hades, and go through a whole nother chapter with him. And I thought that was honestly really, really cool to see. And you also get this cool corrupted look of Hades, which was awesome. I really thought it was a really dope design with the red aura, the black eyes with the red. I thought that was an awesome design for him, and I really thought he really had that final boss feel to him as well. His predecessor, or his ultimate predecessor, QB, had nowhere near as much. The story, it still kind of focused on a big chunk of characters, but it had a lot of relevance around the god characters and everything, which I thought was cool. It kind of just stayed focused on those characters and kind of let the other characters, like the Orochi characters, the Dynasty characters, Samurai characters, they all had their own, like, relevance a little bit here and there, but it was mostly about the gods and everything, which I thought was cool. Kind of throws it off a little bit, since the gods kind of took over Orochi's spotlight, since it's technically named after him and everything. But, you know, I'm sure we'll see him if we get a Warriors Orochi 5, but it was kind of still sad to see that Orochi gets killed off pretty easily, especially the God of Destruction, who gets killed off pretty easily in the story. But nonetheless, I thought it was actually a pretty solid story. It focused on just a specific amount of characters, which I thought was good. That's what they need to do, instead of just trying to sprinkle every single character all over the place. I thought that was really awesome. It gave the Mystics more of a spotlight too, for instance, like Taigong and Yan Jian, who was another character that was added into Warriors Orochi 4 Ultimate, and who also got a deification thing, which I thought was a little left field in my personal opinion. because apparently Tai Gong and Yang Jian had this like rivalry, and then they give Yang Jian just out of the blue, oh hey, guess what, I got this deification form by the way, and it kind of just like kind of ruined the whole rivalry thing that they had. It so in my personal opinion, in terms of power at least, Tai Gong Wong's not really much of a powerhouse or anything like that, but they kind of just made the rivalry in terms of like power at least, and between mystics, kind of silly because they just gave Yang Jian a whole deification form. My personal opinion, I would have loved to see a Wu character get it because not a single Wu character got a deification form, which sucks. They still have not gotten one, but I guess it is what it is. Wu will always get the shaft in Koei Tecmo's eyes. But yeah, so all in all, I thought the story was actually pretty damn good. I was actually way more invested in it than I was in the Warriors Orochi 4 base games story mode. I thought it was actually pretty well done. I think I wouldn't say it was the best, which is why it's not the best. It's in the middle ground right now, but I think it was a really good upgrade from Warriors Orochi 4. It was a great one, and I really was more into it than I was with Warriors Orochi 3 Ultimate, which is why I put it up there higher than 3 Ultimates. Because it had a better final villain, it had some like mystery stuff behind it and everything. You gotta like collect all the fragments to get the true ending and everything. I thought that was actually pretty cool. I actually did like that a lot. But I could go on about it honestly, but I really got the more key stuff out of the way. So we're gonna move on just straight to the next one, which this is where it starts to get a little. This one where it got a little hard for me. So bear in mind, if I could put the next two just at number two, I would have totally done that. So this one technically would be like a 2.5, like skip 3, put it up a notch and put it on 2.5 because I enjoyed them so much. So without further ado, I guess we're going to move on to the next one. And yes, the next one is going to be Warriors Orochi 2. And like I mentioned, we're not mentioning Dream Mode or anything. We're just sticking solely on the story mode. That's it. So obviously, if you put Warriors Orochi 2 with Warriors Orochi 1, I'm personally going to do it for the nostalgia stake. Both those stories are fantastically done. I think it was great because they had different factions for their stories, which did help a lot in terms because they have a huge roster. So obviously you're going to need to put in like separate stories for Wu, Shu, Wei, and Samurai. And obviously with the Samurai characters, they get sprinkled into like the Wu, Shu, and Wei stories as well. And that's vice versa with the Shu, Wu, and Wei officers being sprinkled into the Samurai ones. So let's get to it. I'm going to mention a couple things with it. I had no real gripes about these stories at all. Like I said, this is where it goes from bad, not great, and now it goes to nothing but praise, honestly, in my opinion, because I really did thoroughly enjoy all the next three games that we're about to mention stories. So we'll start with Shu, because obviously this is going to be after the first game, obviously Warriors Orochi. Oh no, actually no, it had another really cool thing, which was technically like a pre-sequel story with Orochi. So let's actually talk about that one first. That was probably the coolest thing that you could start off with. So if you know how Warriors Orochi 1 went, it was like, oh, Orochi just annihilated everything. Just like took out and enslaved people left and right. It was awesome. He really felt like that cool, badass boss. He didn't just come in like, I'm going to take over the world. And then he doesn't. He actually technically did take over the world and had like little people like resistance trying to fight him for it. But they were kind of sucking at it. But so it shows how Orochi went from the very beginning when he escaped the Mystic Realm, and then he ended up going from like attacking, I think he attacks first Odawara, which is the Hojo, and the Toyotomi. So it's really cool to see like him go like just go through all those characters that we saw like had issues with Orochi. He went through like the Toyotomi, he went through the Oda, he went through the Wei army, he went through the Shu army, the Wu army. I think he went through the Takeda and Uesugi at the same time and everything, and then obviously at the very end he went through the Mystics. Honestly, that whole story with Orochi was really cool because it was technically it's a pre-sequel story, so it was really cool to see him plow through all of these people. You play as Orochi right off the bat, which I thought was awesome, and it was a really cool pre-sequel story that they decided to sprinkle in. I thought it was awesome, a really really cool addition to Warriors Orochi 2. But yeah, so now we're going to be going on to Warriors Orochi 2's other stories, which was Shu, Wu, Wei, and Samurai. So for Warriors Orochi 2's, it mostly focused around Liu Bei and I guess you could say also Tadakatsu. For Shu, it was Tadakatsu. Did I say Tadakatsu? I meant to say Ieyasu. I'm an idiot. So yeah, it goes from a Shu Tokugawa is what I was trying to say. It goes from a Shu Tokugawa kind of like dream matchup with one another, like they get to be on the same army and everything, and you get to see those officers of Shu and the Tokugawa all side with each other and obviously get more characters along the way, of course. and be able to just go up against the threat of, like, Lu Bu, go up against the threat of Kiyomori, Sun Wukong, and then obviously eventually also be introduced to the Mystics for the first time, which was Taigong Wong for Shu's army. And it was a really cool thing. Just, it was more straightforward because there wasn't any, like, side, like, missions that you could do, like you could in the base game, which I'll get into when we get to that game next. But it was more of a straightforward one, which is probably why this one's probably, that's probably the sole reason why it's underneath the first games, because the story modes were way more straightforward. You didn't have any, like, side missions. They had, like, optional side missions to go into another final boss and such like that. So that's why this one is probably going to be just getting underneath the story mode for Warriors Orochi 1. But yeah, so it introduced, like, the Mystic Taigong Wong, and then it introduced, obviously, Orochi X, and you didn't have to worry about just fighting him at Koshi Castle for the 18th millionth time like you did in the first game, which I think is another really cool thing. When it came to that one, I don't remember exactly where you fought him. I think you fight him at the Wuzhong Plains in Warriors Orochi 2 for Shu's story. I think that's where you fight him. But nonetheless, and then also, so really all in all, that was a cool story for Shu, and then we go over to Wei. It basically had, like, all of the warlords and such, minus Samurai, which we'll get to in a second, but in terms of that, we'll just sprinkle it in. They each were introduced to a mystic. Almost all of them were. So Wei, Shu, and Samurai all were introduced to a mystic, and then another really cool thing for Wu, instead of getting a mystic, they got introduced to Yoshitsune Minamoto, who at the time was probably one of the coolest characters I ever thought, until they gave him the shaft. But I really thought he was a really awesome character. Yoshitsune was awesome addition. It was a nice twist to see, like, all right, everyone's gonna get a mystic character, I guess. But then I played Wu's story, and this guy wasn't even a mystic. He was just Yoshitsune Minamoto. People have heard about him in Tales and everything, which was awesome. You get to see the rivalry between him and Kiyomori. I guess since we're on the topic, we'll talk about Wu's story, where it has Sun Jian, who's kind of reluctant to go into battle right now and try to endanger everybody. But obviously, it doesn't really help because people keep trying to attack his place, or people are attacking and requesting aid or something from him and such. So he has, like, other people go in there and do his job for him at times. But then eventually, Sun Jian gains the confidence back and ends up attacking Orochi X and Kiyomori and such. Honestly, it was a really cool one to see. It was kind of like a character development from, like, the first game over to the second game, because Sun Jian was hurt that he was endangering so many of his loved ones and everything, and then him finally getting the confidence back to, you, like, you know what, we're gonna go beat Orochi X's ass and end this all once and for all. The Tiger of Jeongdong's back, and we're ready for this. And it was a lot of Yoshitsune's big part in, like, convincing him. It was his family. It was awesome. I think Wu's is probably one of my favorites for that. It had a lot of really fun stages as well. We were introduced to Itsukushima, which was a really cool stage between Lu Bu. Oh, Lu Bu also played a huge part in that story as well. I almost forgot. Lu Bu played a huge part in the Wu story because Yoshitsune and Lu Bu kind of had a rivalry, while also at the same time Yoshitsune was having a rivalry with Kiyomori. Like, they made Yoshitsune a really big deal, and I was so happy to see that because he really is a really cool character, and then they kind of made him not so much. He had his spotlight a bit in Warriors Orochi 3, but in this one specifically, he had a big spotlight on him, which I loved because they were focusing on just, like, Sun Jian, Yoshitsune, Lu Bu, and Kiyomori. Obviously, they had Orochi X, but obviously you don't see him until the very end of the story. But those four characters in particular, like, even the antagonist, they all had, like, huge spotlights there because it all focused around mostly those four characters. It was amazing. It was an amazing time to go through all that, see the character development for Sun Jian, see the rivalry keep building up between Yoshitsune and Lu Bu and Kiyomori. I thought that was awesome. I thought that was a really, really awesome story, and probably my favorite out of all of them. Then we have Samurai, who also went through with Sakon Shima. And he was trying to bring all the warlords of the samurai together. So he was trying to bring in Nobunaga, he was trying to bring in Kenshin, Hideyoshi I know was there, but I'm pretty sure he wasn't that big of a deal apparently. I don't know why. The man conquered Japan for the first time, and nobody really gives him any credit in the Warriors Orochi franchise, in my personal opinion. I think that man deserves more of a spotlight. He kind of gets one in this game in Warriors Orochi. No, he kind of gets one in Warriors Orochi and Warriors Orochi 3, but I feel like that man deserves more love because he was one of the people that conquered Japan. But obviously, I guess that gets overshadowed by the fact that Ieyasu was the one that kind of conquered Japan at the end of the day. But still, I think he deserves more spotlight. But yeah, it was Nobunaga, Hideyoshi, Shingen, Yukimura, Kanetsugu, Kenshin. He was trying to bring all those samurai people in. And obviously, they had their own sprinkled in people here and there with like the Shu, Wu, Wei kind of people and everything. So obviously those characters were a factor as well, but not as big of a factor. This was kind of just mostly strictly samurai people. And I thought that was actually pretty cool to just see samurai just get their own kind of like, get their big roster all together and such. I thought that was pretty cool. There really is. It was basically just Sakon just trying to bring all of them together, basically, to just go up against the big bad Orochi X. There really isn't too much to go on about, but it was really cool to see all those warlords from like Samurai Warriors all just like gang up together to go take out Orochi X. And that is where we were also introduced to the mystic Fushi, who also does try to help his best to try to help out Sakon as best he can, which is a really lovable character. Fushi is probably one of the most lovable mystics in the entirety of the series. Honestly, I wish he did get more spotlight, but he was really good. He did, obviously, since they were first introduced, all the mystics, including Yoshitsune, all got a big spotlight in the story, so obviously that's not the big issue. And he did get a decent amount of spotlight in Warriors Orochi 3 Ultimate and everything, but nonetheless, let's keep on track here. But sorry, when the passion burns bright, I can't help but keep just rambling on. But yeah, honestly, there isn't too much for me to go on about with that. I personally just thoroughly enjoyed Samurai, just seeing all the warlords just band together to take out Orochi X. I thought that was a really sweet, cool thing. But let's move on to, I guess, Wei. I think that's the last one, actually. So Wei, we were talking about with Cao Cao, because like I mentioned, all the warlords are back. They're back in their respective armies and everything. Like Cao Cao's back with Wei, Liu Bei's back with Xu, Sun Jian is the pacifist, is back with Wu. So we have Cao Cao and everything, and then he is introduced to Nuwa. Excuse me. Honestly, for some reason, it's one of my least played of them, but it was actually pretty cool because he was able to bring in like Nobunaga, and at the very end of the boss fight, I know we're just jumping the gun here, but honestly, I don't remember too much about the Wei one. It was a good one, don't get me wrong. It was a really good one. Like the whole game was really great. I love Warriors Orochi 2. But it was really cool to just so the main people that I feel like that were mostly focused around was Cao Cao. I know there was Cao Pi in there, but then we also had Nuwa, who was the most beautiful mystic I've ever seen in my life. She played a big role in it as well, and it was really cool to see like interactions between her and Cao Cao. It was very interesting and very unique compared to like all the other like mystics and Yoshitsune interacting with the main characters of that part. It was really cool to see. And then the very last bit of it was Cao Cao banding together with Nobunaga Oda, who was already in the Samurai story, but it was cool to see Nobunaga still get that love. But at the very least, he tries to band like some people together, and as well, kind of like Samurai, except he bands together Nobunaga's forces, and then he also bands together Wu and Xu. So both Xu and Wu also end up teaming up with Cao Cao, along with the Oda and Wei. All four of those factions just go in and try to take out Orochi X at Guandu, which was a really cool battle. I did not expect that to be a final boss place, but they made it work pretty damn well. I actually liked that final boss. That was probably one of my favorite ones. It was really cool. Just the fact that you could see all of them band together and go fight it was awesome. I really did thoroughly enjoy that story, but man, all right. We're almost there. Two more games to go. So it is time for us to move on to number two. So I basically mentioned it already. The next one is going to be Warriors Orochi 1, the very first game. It was awesome. I'm not going to try to go too deep with this whole thing, but I wanted you guys to at least be able to understand like where I'm coming from with this stuff. I'm not saying understand like these are obviously the best ones. No, I'm not saying that. I want you to understand where I'm coming from with this because I get like all excited about talking about the original stories and everything. It's awesome. I really do like these older games. I need to give them more love on the channel, for God's sakes. I have them where we can play with them with good quality and everything. It's just a matter of me actually making a video of them. But yeah, so let's go on with the next game, and I'm very, very excited. Like I mentioned, it's Warriors Orochi 1. Probably, obviously, for a nostalgia standpoint, since it's the very first, and you first get introduced to the Serpent King, Orochi, obviously this is going to be a big deal right off the bat, and obviously you're going to want to put this way up at the top of the list as one of the best. So this one doesn't actually focus on the warlords specifically, minus Samurai, but this one specifically doesn't really just tackle the warlords. It actually like tackles like loyal retainers or like heirs to the throne or some crap like that. So let's get into it with, I guess we'll just mention with Xu. So we weren't introduced to any mystics here. This was just bare bones humans versus demons, and I thought that was actually pretty cool. So for Xu, we get introduced to Zhao Yun, who's going to be the main character. And then we have Yoshihiro, and then Xing Sai and Ginchio right off the bat with all of them together. So let's just try to get to the nitty-gritty of this stuff. So the main characters, I feel, from my noggin here, the main characters that I feel were like main importance were Zhao Yun, Yukimura, and then the, excuse me. And then the, Magoichi also played a huge part in, which was really cool as well. But Zhuge Liang, who kind of had like an antagonist kind of role throughout the majority of Xu's story, but then eventually ended up going into like the protagonist role literally at the very end of the stage, which was pretty cool. It's like, oh, damn, a turnaround like that? Who saw it coming? You could easily see that coming, by the way. But, yeah. That whole story was really cool, seeing the likes of Yukimura and Zhao Yun have that first... the dream match that people really wanted to see with Yukimura versus Zhao Yun, and then have that dream team of Yukimura and Zhao Yun team up. It was honestly a really cool sight to see. And obviously we had a bunch of other characters. We had like Magawichi helping a bunch of times, trying to figure out exactly where Liu Bei was being held by Orochi and everything. It was honestly, those four characters in particular were really big key players. Like, yeah, we have Guan Yu and Zhang Fei here and there, but I think they only showed up like at Edo Castle, and that really wasn't that big of a deal to me. And yeah, so personally, I think that the shoe story was a really good one. It was really cool. Honestly, that was the one I officially started off with. I tried to do them in chronological order here and there, but it was kind of hard. I'm not gonna lie, but at the times it was pretty easy to do. But yeah, so that story was also pretty cool. It was basically shoe going up against all the people who were imprisoned by Orochi, and you had to try to like either save them or convince them to go join you. Because they didn't want to risk Liu Bei or anyone else in Shu dying or anything like that by the hands of Orochi or Daji. So, and obviously Daji plays another big role. This is literally where she debuts along with Orochi. They were sort of the only two demon playable characters. So obviously those two are big names right off the bat. So obviously that's going to be a thing. But yeah, so that's basically what they try to do. They try to like rescue those people who were enslaved. Or they try to recruit people who are, like, just mixed around, part of the resistance group and everything. And obviously try to, like, convince these guys, look, we can work together to save our lord, so let's go do that instead. So that's what they try to do throughout the majority of the story. They also have those cool side objectives, those optional ones. If you complete all of those optional objectives by also doing the correct objectives for them as well, then you'll be able to get a second final boss, which is really cool. If you don't beat Orochi first, you actually get I think it's actually just a battle with Daji, and it could differ, I think, from time to time. Maybe it could be Lu Bu. I think one time it was Dong Zhuo, but one of the stories I do believe it was Daji, who was technically the final boss of that of those. Like, I think they were just called like 1X, 2X, 3X, and then like 8X or 10X, whatever the hell it was. But yeah, it was honestly really cool to go like back and forth between all of them. And obviously, once you get those objectives done right in those X missions, then you would also be able to unlock a character for that stage. So there was always something to gain from it every single time. I thought that was a really cool added feature, like optional feature. But if you wanted to get the whole experience and also get Orochi, which you needed to beat every... And Daji, I think. You needed to beat every single stage in the game in order to unlock. I think it was just Orochi, in my personal opinion. But it was really cool to see something like that. And that's also how you would get the likes of Lu Bu. You'd get the likes of Tadakatsu, who they made really big deals. So they try to make it tough to unlock them and everything, instead of just getting them, like, just completing this part of the story or this part of the story. In the first game, they made him such a big deal that they made it so where Tadakatsu and Lu Bu, you had to do special things. You either had to beat Lu Bu up every single time, and then you had to do certain objectives for Tadakatsu as well during his stages in order to unlock him, which was pretty cool. So personally, I think that whole thing was really, really dope to have those two characters. And even Keiji, like, he was part of the Wu story, just specifically the Wu story. But he actually had a pretty tedious damn objective, might I say, to get him unlocked as well. Which, granted, those are the three most powerful characters in, like, Samurai and Dynasty. So obviously you'd want to make them hard to get. So honestly, it felt like maybe a grind. At the same time, it really didn't. Like, it was a grind that you wouldn't mind doing to get those characters. It was really cool. But let's move on before I keep going off topic. But that is a really cool feature that I'm glad they added in the stories and everything. But yeah, so we went from Shu. I guess we'll go to Wei, which I want to just mention are the main... Like, they focus on a select few in each force. So in this case, they focused on mainly Cao Pi, Mitsunari, and they also... I guess you could also mention the Shahos were also in there as well. Yeah, the Shaho Dun, Shaho Yuan. You could also mention that they were big parts of it as well, trying to like see, like, is Cao Pi really able to lead Wei like Cao Cao can? And that's basically what they were doing the entire time, because they were part of the resistance. Cao Pi was part of like Daji's army at the time, or Orochi's army at the time. And they were like, traitor. And Cao Pi was like, this is all part of the grand scheme of things, or some crap like that. And it was cool to see him like convince Shaho Dun and Shaho Yuan, like, yo, relax. I'm still one of you guys. I'm just doing things my way, and it may differ from my father, but I'm still doing things my way, and I'm doing it for the sake of humanity and crap. My methods just may seem different than his. And then that was able to convince him, like, alright, Cao Pi's pretty dope. And then eventually Cao Cao came in anyway and kind of took his moment of glory. They even mentioned it. They're like, Mitsunari's even like, damn, that man just stole your moment of glory. And he's like, eh, That's literally how Salpi kind of looked at it as. He was like, eh. But yeah. So it was, in all, it's a really cool story. I really do like seeing, like, Salpi, like, try to, like, go behind the scenes and everything, like, working along faithfully, might I add, with Dodgy and Orochi and everything. Mostly Dodgy, because Orochi wasn't shown until the very end of the story. But yeah, it was really cool to see, like, Salpi just try to, like, manipulate behind the scenes and everything, and then eventually just, yo, I'm leaving you now, and then actually, I think it even, like, takes Dodgy prisoner in some of the missions, and it's really cool. It's a really, really cool thing to see. Like, I really do like Salpi's in particular, because his is really good in terms of, like, trying to, like, just try to be manipulative behind the scenes, try to get allies grown up for doing good deeds for Dodgy and everything. It was really cool. I really do like that. So, I guess next we can move on. Actually, I want to move on to Samurai, because I want to say Wu for last, because Wu, once again, is probably one of my favorite ones, because it was really good in terms of character development and all that stuff. But let's go on to Samurai. So, for Samurai, this was Nobunaga basically just bringing in a bunch of, like, people and everything like that. He was basically one of the big leaders of the resistance and everything. So, it was really cool to see Nobunaga get such a huge role, and which makes sense. This man's called the Demon King. He had a big persona going on in terms of Samurai Warriors, so it would be obvious to make him a leader of the resistance in Warriors Orochi as well. So for that, it was pretty cool. You start off with Nobunaga, Mitsuhide, and Hideyoshi right off the bat, main loyal retainers of the Oda. One of them, you know, the first conqueror of Japan, but still, I feel like that man still deserves more love, Hideyoshi. But it was cool to see, and also the man who killed Nobunaga, but apparently still faithful to him nonetheless. But yeah, it was basically Nobunaga just rounding up a bunch of people, meeting them all up at Koshi Castle, and then just having like I think you even get like reinforcements from like all the forces. They're not particularly like, I don't think they were like Liu Bei or Sao Tse, but they were like just random soldiers that you get from like Wei, Wu, and Shu at Koshi Castle and everything. And then it basically ends up being one giant coalition they go to take out Orochi with. So I at the end of the day, I think his final boss fight was actually really cool for Samurai. I think that the Samurai one was probably the best one, but there really isn't too much to go on about. Like, he was basically just rounding up all these, like, rulers and everything, and then basically Sokkon in the second game was just doing a rinse and repeat of what Nobunaga already did. But it really was a cool sight to see, like, all of them, like, gang up again once again together and go take out Orochi. So let's move on to probably my favorite one, which was... It is going to be Wu's. Wu's was done really, really well. Obviously, it is a conflict between family. You play as Sunse, you have Ieyasu, Hanzo right off the bat and everything. And then, like Salpi was, Sunse was basically a prisoner of Orochi. And he and Dodgy was basically ordering him to do these battles for her, these battles. And every time he would do a battle, he would get a friend back in return. So that's basically what he was trying to do. He was basically just trying to work along getting all of his officers from Wu back, or any other officer for that matter, because I know he gets like Runmaru, but he was part of the resistance at the time. And so it was, and so he basically just tries to do all that, and then eventually also bring his family back together, which people are not the people, but his family is conflicted about. Like Sun Quan and then Sun Sheng Shang are all like, well, this man's a traitor because he tried to go save Dad when we're just trying to work to get him to keep him alive and all that stuff, while you're jeopardizing his life by trying to save him and everything. It was really cool because at Sekigahara, it all basically comes full circle in terms of, like, at least I don't remember about Sun Quan, but at least with Sun Sheng Shang, they all just basically come together. She comes together with Sunse and everything. And then Ina also plays a big factor into the story as well with trying to convince Sun Sheng Shang, like, is this really what you want to do? You really want to go up against your big brother like this? You really want to, like, put your blade to his throat or something like that? And so it's honestly just a really cool thing. Like, it's a lot of conflicting, like, family fighting going on. But it's also at the same time to Sunse trying to bring everyone back together. It was such an amazing thing. And then you're finally getting to the final boss fight after you save Sun Quan, after you save Sun Jian, and you go and put all four of them together with their powers combined. And apparently this was also canon that the Sun family are the ones that actually end up killing Orochi. So the reason why I say this, I remember in a cutscene that it shows in Warriors Orochi 4, that it shows the Sun family actually impaling the crap out of Orochi from all four sides. Which was weird for Sun Sheng Shang's instance, but Sunse's, because he had a Tonfa. But yeah, they basically all just like impale him with their weapons, and then apparently that's it for Warriors Orochi 4. So apparently that's the canon ending. The canon ending actually, I guess, is the Sun family taking out Orochi, which I think is actually pretty cool, seeing that the Sun family would get get the credit they finally deserve and finally be able to have like a moment of glory, because obviously in later games Wu doesn't really get that moment of glory. But yeah, all in all, I think the story was incredible. It was awesome to go through that story for the very first time. It's hell, it's even great to go through it even like later, all these years later. It's still awesome to feel like you're going through it for the first time and everything. It's such a cool thing to relive those stories. That's why Orochi 1 is so far up there. But let us go on finally to the very, very last one. Number 1 on the list. And here we are at the very last one, which is, of course, Warriors Orochi 3. So, contrast to Warriors Orochi 1 and 2, this one didn't have like a bunch of like forces put together and everything like that. It didn't have like Wu, Wei, Shu, Samurai, all different stories. This one was just one giant timeline of events with three characters in particular that had the spotlight, which was an awesome idea. Somehow they made something that felt like it was going to be like, oh, it's going to be a jumbled mess with just one story and all these characters. No, far from it, in fact. They focused on a certain, just a few characters in particular. So the main characters for that one were very likable characters as well, mind you. So great options by that. One was the debut of the Jin forces, which had Sima Zhao, who was the conqueror of China, apparently. And then, who at least beat Shu, and apparently, all said and done. But yeah, so Sima Zhao, Ma Chao, who everyone loves, apparently. Everyone in the Dynasty community, obviously if you look at him historically, probably not. But if you look at him from the Dynasty factor, yeah, he's a very lovable character. And then you have Hanbei Takanaka, who is literally just Zhuge Liang, but has more personality, 100%. But those three characters in particular are the very last playable characters that you get to that are alive during the time of the Hydra attack, which is those giant serpents that came out of just hell, I guess, and just started like just rampaging and killing everybody with the demon army and everything. So it was up to Sima Zhao, Ma Chao, and Hanbei to try to go combat the hybrid. Unfortunately, they didn't have the requirements at the time to do it, so they were like, oh crap, we're gonna die to a hybrid. Or hybrid. Sorry, hybrid's tails on the head. But to the hybrid. Hydra. Good lord, I'm a fool. To the Hydra. So as they're about to go die, they end up running into the next main character that gets introduced heavily, which is Kaguya. Another new mystic, really cool to see. They started introducing more and more mystics, which I was really all for. It was really cool to see. But introduced her, and she's like, yo, I can reverse time. Let's go back in time before you guys fought the Hydra, and let's go try to gang some more allies and such. And they were like, let's do it! And so they end up doing that. It's basically them just trying to save other people. And another really cool thing that they did, apparently, characters can die in Warriors Orochi, believe it or not. Like, it's crazy. You'd think the only person who could die in Warriors Orochi was Orochi himself. But no, a bunch of other characters could die, and you had to go through, like, certain stages, do, like, redux stages, which were actually cool because those redux stages can actually, like, make a difference, unlike the Warriors Orochi 3 Ultimate ones, where you kind of go through, like, take out the Kyuubi tails and all that crap. But this one, the reduxes actually made a difference, and they were really cool. So you had to go through, like, the story once and go out and witness some characters die, like, oh no, I'm dead. But then you end up going in and doing a different stage. You go to talk to certain people at the camp, make sure their stuff, I guess, make sure at times their, what's the word I'm looking for here? Just for the reduxes in particular, you go to talk to some people in the camp, they're like, you know, I remember some guy not making it out of that battle. We should go to a different battle so we can prevent that from happening. And then those characters are like, let's do it! And then they go do that, and then you go into the Redux, which technically, let's say Huang Zhong, for instance, who's the very first one. He is the very first character that you run into in terms of dying. Literally, I think it's like the second mission at Yiling. He literally just sacrifices himself, and it's over. He's dead. But then some people end up saying, like, yo, actually, if we get these catapults and stuff, we'll be able to break down that gate and go save Huang Zhong. So that's what you do in a different stage. You go get the catapult, and then you go do that stage again with which is the Redux. And then you end up going to save Huang Zhong after you annihilate that gate with the catapult. And it's basically stuff like that, and they also can bring into factors of other things. I know, like, you could say, like, Diao Chan, who ends up dying to Neza because she had nowhere to run to, and then you bring boats at Tong Gate. At the bottom right, there was no ships there, but now that there's ships there, she can just bolt over to your main camp and go, and then you can go save her from Neza. It's that kind of stuff that was really cool. But back on track here. With Sima Zhao, Ma Chao, and Hanbei and Kaguya. So they go back in time trying to rescue all these people from dying, trying to rewrite history and everything so they can get all the allies, and then they can go back into the present day with and try to go fight the Hydra. And then also it's really cool because Taigong Wong gets a gets a big spotlight in this as well, which is, he's one of my favorite mystics. I know some people give him flack for his attitude and everything, but I personally like the character. I adore Tai Gong Wong. I like his combat style. I like his character and everything, his brilliance. It's really cool. But then they also mention Shuten Doji, who is apparently, spoiler alert, is the conscience of the former Orochi, which is why the Hydra is so, like, crazily, like, oh, destruction, because I guess Shuten Doji and Orochi, I guess, is a split. So the Hydra came to be and all that crap, and then the Hydra was like, bam, destroy everything. And then the god of destruction, Orochi, came into the picture, and he's like, I have no emotion. I must destroy you all. I don't know why I tried to do that in Android 16 voice, but nonetheless. Yeah. So another one, which was Shuten Doji, who had like amnesia or memory loss or some crap like that, and Tai Gong's like, I'll help you if you allow us to help use your energy or whatever to get this really powerful weapon to defeat the Hydra. And Shuten Doji's like, all right, let's do it. So basically throughout the rest of it is Sima Zhao, Ma Chao, Hanbei, Kaguya getting all their allies back, going up against the Hydra and all that stuff, and trying to bring in this big giant cannon weapon. I don't even know how to say it. It's like the Yoshiharu. I'll put it up on the screen so y'all can see what it is. Like the name. I don't know how the editing is going to go for this video. I don't know yet, but I'll at least put up the text of how to say it. But anyway, yeah. So they're basically just trying to like now transport all of these things to like castles and everything, and then eventually bring it into the Hydra's lair to where they can beat that Hydra's ass. And then eventually, they gave birth to like 8 Orochis. Literally, they gave birth to 8 Orochis. Those Hydras that eventually were defeated took the manifestation of Orochi himself, but they were mindless destruction character, like Orochis, like, ah, destruction, or end me, or destruction is me, or some crap like that. And you had to go into like some huge boss fight with all of them, all 8 Orochis. You gotta go fight alongside like Daji. You gotta go fight alongside Kaguya and a bunch of other people. You go deeper into the Hydra's lair, and then you end up fighting those Orochis, and then eventually after you defeat those Orochis, here comes the birth of the God of Destruction, Orochi X, which, I'm not gonna lie, pretty dope. I kinda was hoping that, like, maybe he would get, like, a third form for being a God of Destruction. Maybe be able to at least have, like, a new moveset with, like, 2 sides or something, maybe do something like that, but, no, it was just Orochi X, which I thought was a bit of a letdown. That was probably the only letdown I thought was about it, but he was strong. He was very strong to go up against, and they had a new and improved Koshi Castle and everything. It was awesome. And then we'll also get into the fact with guest characters as well, but I just wanted to point out the main story parts first. But yeah, so they go into this new and improved Koshi Castle and everything, depending on which ending you get, because you can get different endings. Of course you can. It's Warriors Orochi 3. Because not every single one had one, but yeah, so you go into new and improved Koshi Castle, you go fight that very powerful God of Destruction, go fight that Kiyomori and all that such, and depending on which ending you can get a happy ending with everyone's like still together, and they're in this like twisted realm of Samurai and Dynasty Warriors characters, and they all leave happily laughing away as Kaguya just stares, I guess, at Orochi X's dead-ass body. But and then there's also the true ending, apparently, which is called World's End, I think it's called, where you go and fight Orochi X, and then you end up, and then everything just ends up being, like, finally fixed once and for all. The Dynasty characters go back to China, the Japanese characters go back to Japan, Samurai characters, that's what I'm trying to say. The Samurai characters go back to Japan, their worlds are no longer mixed together, they're back to normal and everything, which I think is technically still the canon story, or the canon ending, not the Kyuubi one. I think that one is still the canon one, because they don't even mention Kyuubi. So I imagine it's just, So I imagine World's End is actually the true canon ending, if I'm not mistaken, because they never mentioned Kyuubi, I don't think. But, yeah, so that's basically how that one goes. And they also did bring in the addition of guest characters. They brought in Ayane, they brought in Ryu, they brought in Joan of Arc, they brought in Achilles. They probably brought in some other characters. I know the Warriors Orochi 3 Ultimate roster brought in some other characters, like Momiji. They brought in Rachel, they brought in, Sturkenberg. They brought in a bunch of characters, basically, but those 4 characters in particular, Ayane, Ryu, Achilles, and Joan, were the only guest characters, if I'm not mistaken. I could be wrong. Be sure to correct me if I'm wrong. I'm doing this off the noggin. I do this off script, but I just speak from the gut and the heart. You know how I go by now. But yeah, so that's basically how everything ends up going, and it's probably one of the best stories because it gives great character development for all 3 characters. One who's just like Sima Zhao, who's normally lazy and just doesn't want to do anything. It's becoming an amazing leader. Then we have Ma Chao, who's like in self-doubt a lot. and everything, but gains his confidence back to like, we're going to go beat that Hydra's ass. And then we got Hanbei, who's normally just takes things for granted, and he's normally just more laid back, and he ends up being more serious about the whole thing. Like, all right, I gotta rack my brain up and make sure this is for humanity's sake. We're gonna do this. So all of them get really great character development, and all the other characters tend to notice that kind of stuff. Like, damn, you seem like, for instance, like people with Sima Zhao, they're like, you seem a lot more serious and a lot more like ready to be a leader and such. And he's like, I don't know, I guess it's just the world's ending, so I gotta smarten up and everything. So stuff like that was really cool to see that character development. And then obviously you see the character development of like Kaguya, because thanks to like Kai and what's her face, Sun Shang Shang and everything. So you get character development from a lot of great characters and a lot of great connections for certain characters, not every single character. Like, obviously, when you get all the rulers together, you do get, like, that final boss fight with all of them together. But then if you do, like, the canon ending, you get, like, a bunch of just random characters help out to go up against Orochi X. Personally, I still do like the Orochi X's Demise, I think it's called. But that's my favorite between the two, because, one, I guess I'm just a happy ending kind of guy. But not to mention, I liked the lineup more with all the rulers together to go fight Orochi X than just a bunch of random people that were just thrown in there for my think, like, if you need, like, for ones that you needed to increase bonds with and do, like, those optional ones. That's the only gripe I had. You had to increase people's bonds, which technically actually isn't that hard if you have the money for it. And then you could just do, like, one battle with them and then, like, oh, all said and done. Now I can go do that mission. It was a bit of a grind, but it was kind of easy to get through after my second playthrough of the game. Thank you, Xbox, for breaking on my game. But, actually, no, my third playthrough, because I had Warriors Odyssey 3 on Xbox 360. I had Warriors Odyssey 3 Ultimate on Xbox One, and then I had to move it over to the PS4. So that's actually, I've actually played this game 3 whole times. Good lord. But nonetheless, the Warriors Orochi 3 story is probably by far my most favorite story of all. They did so many right things with that, and I can't help but adore that game with its story so much. 3 Ultimate, no, minus Orochi's upbringing, but no, QB sucked. But they should have put in Hundun instead. I think Hundun would have been really dope. Probably swap him out, let QB be the gauntlet mode person, and then let Hundun be the final boss for Warriors Odyssey 3 Ultimate, because he was more of a final boss than QB was, that's for damn sure, in gauntlet mode. But alright guys, that is going to be the end of it. That was all of them. Good lord, I know I missed out on like Warriors Odyssey Z and all that stuff, but we're talking about the ones that just made it to like internationally, like it became to the U.S., it came from this country, not just specifically Japan. And not to mention, I can't read Japanese, so I don't know how great that story truly is. So yeah, we're just doing it based off the games that came around internationally, came to the U.S. and all that other stuff. So guys, like I said, if you all do enjoy it, this is the outro stuff. I'm an idiot. So if you all did enjoy it, sorry, I'm rambling on. So my brain is running on fumes right now. If you all did enjoy it, then be sure to hit that like button. Comment down below right now. List your favorites Warriors Orochi stories from your least favorite Warriors Orochi stories. Do it right now. Comment it down below. If you want to give your reasons why, be part of this very jumbled up mess of a video, then by all means, go ahead and do it. And then obviously, if you're new to the channel, link to content that you see, then you can always be sure to hit that sub button. I would really appreciate it. Also, I do a Discord's Choice with Warriors game. So what that means is I do a bunch of, like, I pick a game, like, for instance, we'll just say Warriors Odyssey 3 Ultimate. I have, like, a gauntlet team, and I let the Discord decide who's going to be on that gauntlet team. At times, I'll do it for YouTube comments. I'm actually doing it. I've actually been doing it this week. I had a video planned for it. I don't know when this video is coming out, if this is coming out Monday, or if it's coming out Friday, maybe, taking over my Zelda playthrough or something. But, yeah. So, if you want to take part in the Discord's Choice, then by all means, down in the description below, there is the link for Discord. It is called the Wowies of Jigoku, and I will always ping at you all whenever I do a Discord's Choice. And you guys, it's normally a first-come, first-served, but other times it's just based on characters I haven't played with on my channel yet or something like that, or characters I find interesting, or ones that are my favorites. Normally, I don't try to do that. I try to do, like, ones I haven't really showcased much on my channel. But yeah, if you want to do that, down in the description right there. I do also have a Patreon, which I need to put in the description. I'll be sure to remember to do that. If you guys do want to support the channel by any means necessary, then by all means, you can start at the $1 tier, and you can put your name somewhere on the video. I don't know if I have it on this one in particular, but I'll definitely have it up on other ones. If not, I'll put it on my outro, so y'all can check it out. If you do want to support, like I said, you could literally just start at the $1 tier, and then there's another one, I think it's like $5 tier, if you want to do that as well, which comes with more benefits. By all means, It would be greatly supported. No, I'm not struggling financially. People said I should do it, and I'm doing it. And some people have been very gracious enough to be able to support me, and I can't thank you all enough for that. I can't thank you all enough for all the support you've been giving me all across the board. So thank you all very much. And I guess with all that being said, guys, thank you all very much for watching, and I'll see you all in the next video. Farewell. Save it.